According to the Bible. What does the Bible say about truth? What is truth? Our people have been walking in falsehood and lies all their lives, not knowing who they are, not knowing where they come from, not knowing how God feels about them. Well, it's your time to learn the truth. Bring it up.
Psalms chapter 119, verse 142.
Bring it up.
Thy righteousness is an everlasting righteousness, and thy law is the truth.
The laws of God is the truth. That's the truth that we have as a people have been disenfranchised, been separated from, and have been completely lost. Therefore, we are destroyed today for the lack of knowledge. Our people do not know who we are. So we are here to teach that knowledge and give it back into the rightful hands of the children of God.
Bring it up.
Read what you got.
Hosea chapter 4, verse 6.
Bring it up.
My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge.
God says, my people, the so-called Israelites, the so-called blacks, Hispanics, and Native Americans that have been taken into another place and have been stripped from their history and heritage. Those people are destroyed today. Keep reading.
My people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge.
They're destroyed for that lack of knowledge. What does the Bible say that knowledge is? Is it me having a PhD? Is it me understanding math? What knowledge is the Bible talking about?
Read out.
Read.
No.
Yes.
Malachi chapter 2, verse 7. For the priest's lips should keep knowledge.
The priest is the so-called pastors of today. He is the one that's supposed to be giving the knowledge according to the Bible.
Right.
Your pastors, Creflo Dollars, TD Snakes, and all these other fakes, they are not giving you the laws of God. Read.
And they should seek the law and his mouth.
That's the job of a priest, to teach the laws of the Bible.
Right.
That's what we're out here to do, to teach the laws of God that we have been disconnected from.
Right. That's right.
For he is the messenger of the Lord of hosts.
We are the messengers of the Lord of hosts. Let's give you some of the messages of the words of God.
Yeah.
Let's get you to understand the importance of what today is. Today is the Sabbath of the Lord. It is the holy Sabbath of the Lord. We are not here to buy. We are not here to sell. We're not supposed to do any work. This is the day that we are supposed to keep holy, as it is commanded in the Bible. Read what you got.
Exodus chapter 20, verse 8. Remember the Sabbath day.
And this is out of the Ten Commandments. The same Ten Commandments that your grandma got on her wall. The same Ten Commandments that you quote, so-called, in the Christian church. But this is one of the commandments that we as a people do not keep. We do not know what the Sabbath is today. We've been disenfranchised from our history. We've been disenfranchised from our culture. We've been disconnected and discontinued. Read it again.
Exodus chapter 20, verse 8. Remember the Sabbath day.
It says remember, because one day we will forget. One day we was going to be cut off from our heritage. One day we were going to be cut off from our true history. So he that have an ear, let him hear what thus says the Lord today. Today is his holy day. Read.
Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy.
He said, remember the Sabbath day, black man. Remember the Sabbath day. Come back to God's commandments.
Yes,
come back to God's heritage, to his laws. Come back to your greatness. Read.
6 days shalt thou labor.
So you have 6 days to do your labor. You have 6 days to do your work. You have 6 days to do whatever you need to do, whatever business you have. Read.
And do all thy work.
Uh-huh.
But the seventh day.
But the seventh day, that is the day of the Lord's rest. Read.
But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work.
We are commanded not to do any work, not any buying, any selling. Let's see how important the Sabbath day is according to Exodus 31.
Bring it on.
Because that is the secret sign between the children of Israel and our Heavenly Father.
Right.
All these people walking around saying they have a personal relationship with God. This is how you know that you truly have a personal relationship with God.
Yeah.
You respect and keep reverence on his Sabbath day. Read what you got.
Exodus chapter 31, verse 16.
Bring it up. Start back up a little bit at 14.
Verse 14. Ye shall keep the Sabbath.
It says, ye shall keep the Sabbath. It was no debate. He said, ye shall keep the Sabbath. This is a commandment. This is a commandment even to this day. Keep reading.
For it is holy unto you.
Because it is holy. For something to be holy, it means it is set apart. There's a difference between this day and all the rest of the days of the week. Keep reading.
Everyone that defileth it shall surely be put to death.
So God said, everyone that defiled his day shall surely be put to death.
Right.
It shows you that this is a serious deal. This is not something to be taken lightly. This is literally life and death. Read.
For whosoever doeth any work.
He said, for whosoever doeth any work. How you doing, sister? We're teaching on the Sabbath day. You got some time to listen and learn about your heritage, about your history? I see you about to bring new life into this world. Are you going to be prepared to teach your child what your child is and who they come from? The greatness of your history.
Right.
That's to the people we trying to reach out to. Matter of fact, give me that in Psalms where it say, wisdom cried aloud. Because Psalms 1, Proverbs 1, where it says, wisdom cried aloud. Because that's what we out here to do. We out here to cry aloud. And wisdom is speaking out to her children. Are any of her children out here that's going to listen? Read.
Proverbs chapter 1, verse 20.
Read it out.
Wisdom crieth without. She utters her voice in the streets.
Because we are out here speaking the words of wisdom. We're teaching you the law, statutes, and commandments. We're crying without. No one has time of the day to listen about their history. No one has time of day. But guess what? As was the days of Noah, so is today. People will be buying and selling and giving it to marriage and all these other things before Christ comes back and all hell breaks loose. But we are the last voice of warning and reason that you're going to hear in Blackfield. Read.
She crieth in the chief place of concourse.
We are crying in the chief place of concourse. We're crying in the middle of the town square to teach the lost sheep that it's time to come home.
Right.
Read.
In the opening of the gates.
Uh-huh.
In the city, she uttereth her voice,
Wisdom is crying out to her children. Who will listen? Who will stand up for God? Who will come back and do what that is pleasing in his sight? Who's going to keep the Sabbath day? Now let's get back to the Sabbath day. I'm going to show you why it's so important to keep this day holy. You got to understand, the Sabbath day has always been the seventh day. The seventh day of the week has always been Saturday. So all you God lovers out there that go to church on Sunday, you should reevaluate your faith.
Right.
Read.
Exodus chapter 31, verse 15.
Read out.
6 days may work be done.
6 days so you do all your work and your labor. Keep reading.
But in the seventh is the Sabbath of rest.
The Sabbath is the day of holy rest. Why do you think the Spanish word for Saturday is sábado? Because it has always been Saturday. Saturday has always been the Sabbath according to God.
Right.
Keep reading.
Holy to the Lord.
It's always been holy unto God. Keep reading.
Whosoever doeth any work in the Sabbath day, he shall surely be put to death.
Again, the Most High is making it clear, very plain and clear, how important the Sabbath day is to keep. Read.
Wherefore, the children of Israel.
The children of Israel. Notice he didn't mention all people on the face of the earth.
Right.
Guess what? The Bible was not given unto all people. It was given to a special select group.
Right.
The lost sheep his children. That's why God has to reemphasize he only deals with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob.
That's right.
He could have just stopped at Adam if it was for everybody, but it's not. That's why it's talking about the children of Israel right here. Read.
Wherefore the children of Israel shall keep the Sabbath to observe the Sabbath throughout their generations.
Because the Sabbath day is something special to an Israelite. That's our thing. That's our heritage. That's our blood right. Read.
The Sabbath throughout their generations for a perpetual covenant.
That was a perpetual covenant. An unending agreement that we made with the Father. That's something that no one can take away from us.
That's right.
It is a sign between me and the children of Israel. Forever.
How long?
Forever.
Forever. Forever. We are always supposed to be keeping the Sabbath day.
Right.
That should be something we look forward to throughout the week.
We know.
That should be something that's special between us and the Father, where we can commune with the Father, and he'll commune with our spirit. And we come together, we teach our people.
And we know the foundation. The
reason why we don't have that today is because we've been taught lies. We have been taken away from our true heritage. Shalom, brothers, come and talk with us. We are here for y'all. Because it's been too long that we've been sitting in darkness.
Right.
It's been too long that we have not been told the true nature of our being.
Yeah.
The true nature of who we are as a people.
Yeah.
That's been stripped away from us as soon as we got here on the slave ships. But not today.
You're going to learn today.
You're going to learn today who you are. And you're going to learn what time it is. It is time, high time for us to wake up out of this sleep state. Wake up. It's time for us to wake up and retake this earth.
That's right.
Let's see if the Bible says the same thing. Read what you got.
Romans chapter 13, verse 11.
Read out.
And that, knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep.
Now it is high time to wake up out of sleep. Our people are so asleep, they don't understand the world events that's going on. They have no idea. But the other nations know. The other nations are very informed of what's going on. They even got a society called the Doomsday Preppers. When they get in the underground bunkers, because they know the judgment is coming.
Right.
But guess what? Our people are still asleep.
Right.
We still concerned about what's going on in the playoffs.
Right.
We still concerned about little trivial things.
Right.
But not knowing that the world is setting the stage for World War III.
That's right.
Right.
That's why the Bible says it is high time. Read that again.
And that, knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep.
It is high time to wake out of sleep. Read.
For now is our salvation nearer than when we believe.
Guess what? Christ is just around the corner. Just around the corner.
Yep.
Are you going to believe in God right now? Or are you going to believe in God when it's too late? Are you going to believe in the scriptures now? Or are you going to believe when you see that fire coming from heaven?
Yep.
This is your time now. While you still have a chance to repent.
Right.
How you doing, man? I see y'all got the clock. We can definitely share some information with y'all if y'all got the time. Today is the Lord's Sabbath day. Now we know y'all have heard of the Ten Commandments before, right? And keeping the Sabbath day is holy, right? Let's see how God feels about the Sabbath day. This is something that's supposed to be special and holy unto the children of Israel. Read that.
Exodus chapter 31, verse 16. Wherefore the children of Israel shall...
You see that? Who are the children of Israel today, sis? Who are the children of Israel today? It is not the people in that land called Israel.
Right.
Because surely they have called themselves the Israelites, not the Israelites.
Right.
The Bible only talks about the Israelites. So who are the Israelites today?
Read up.
Read.
Wherefore the children of Israel shall keep the Sabbath to observe the Sabbath throughout their generation.
Hey, sister, you ever been told that you're an Israelite? Sister walking around right there with the thing in her hair, how you doing?
I know, but guess what? I'm going to be wearing all the numbers as a wee soft, sister.
Right.
Come and talk with us right quick. Let me just drop a little bit of knowledge. You got to say it all of that.
Bring it out.
It's all right. You got to be scared. Because guess what, sister? Have you ever been told that you're a princess?
that you descend from royalty?
Bring it out.
Have you ever been told that your ancestors are the very men that the Bible speaks of? Have you been told that Jesus Christ is coming back to save his people and he looks just like you? Have you been told anything, any of these things? Let me deal with one thing at a time. Now, when you Google Jesus Christ, what does he look like? He white, right? That's what you come up with. Let's see if the Bible tells you how Jesus Christ looked like.
Bring it up.
You have people ignorantly say nobody seen Jesus Christ. I'm like, well, who did they nail on the cross? A ghost? That's a good question. If a man physically walked here on the face of the earth, and he is the greatest man that ever walked on the face of the earth, hell, we dictate time based off of the life and death of Jesus Christ.
Bring it up.
So it's easy to say that Jesus Christ is the greatest man that walked on the face of the earth. Surely people have seen him and made record and note of what he looks like.
Bring it up.
Read the description.
Revelation chapter 1, verse 1.
Bring it up.
The revelation of Jesus Christ.
The root word of revelation means to reveal. To reveal. Keep reading.
Which God gave unto him to show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass. And he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John.
Unto a servant who?
His servant John.
Now, unlike a lot of so-called Christians, John was actually one of the favorite disciples that Christ had.
Right. You know? Right.
He actually had a personal relationship with Jesus Christ.
Right.
For real, for real. Alright, let's go to the actual description of what John wrote in a book.
Verse
how did he describe his friend, Jesus the Christ?
Verse 14, his head and his hair were white like wool.
So I said the hair on his head was white and had the texture of wool. Now, I would need you to do a side-by-side comparison of these two images. Let's say you had to do a sketch of somebody that broke into your house. You're going to get a description, right? Now, if you say, hey, you know, the person, he had white woolly hair, which one would you point to? Which one fit the description? Okay, that. So that's strike one. He really?
As white as snow.
Uh-huh.
And his eyes were as a flame of fire.
Now, why was his eyes as a flame of fire? Because we might look at that and be like, oh, well, you know, it's just another whatever. It's a lot more simpler than what it seems. The Bible has an answer for everything.
Yeah.
What you got?
Genesis chapter 49, verse 12.
Uh-huh.
His eyes shall be red with wine.
Now, what was Jesus' first miracle? Do you know, sister? It was turning water into wine. You know what I'm saying?
Read up.
Let's go back to Revelation. Read.
Revelation chapter 1, verse 14. His head and his hairs were white like wool.
His head and his hairs were white like wool.
As white as snow.
As white as snow. See, they made that distinction to show you it wasn't just... They didn't say wool just because it was white, because you can have black wool. You can have different colors of wool, right? Wool was the description of the texture. Snow was a description of the color. Read on.
And his eyes were as a flame of fire.
Now we understand that. Read on.
And his feet.
And his feet. What's your name, sister? Kiki? My name is Kiki. Nice to see you. Now, Kiki, your feet. I'm looking at them. But I'm going to say anybody's feet, right? It's a fair guess that if your feet is the color, then the rest of your body is going to be the same color, right? So let's see what Jesus Christ's feet look like.
Read up!
And his feet like unto fine brass.
Now, do you know what fine brass looks like? You ever heard of bronze? Have you ever seen a penny? That will be close to the description of what they're talking about.
Right.
Let's see what complexion of brown it really is.
Read up!
As if they burned in a furnace.
Now, Kiki, if you got some toast, right? You left it in the toaster too long. Is it going, how is it going to come out? It's going to come out black. So, at least two descriptions, which one is truly Jesus Christ in the Bible? So why do we see this other image in the church?
Bring it out.
So that should be, that's a head-scratching moment. Because guess what? The Bible says, he that believeth on me, as the scriptures say, out of his belly is going to flow rivers of living water. That means you're going to have the true understanding of the Bible, the true understanding of who you are,
right,
the true understanding of what you must do to inherit the kingdom of God.
That's right!
Kiki, us as a people, we took a lot of L's. I mean, we taking L's every day. Don't we need a win? We definitely need to win. We definitely need to save it. But guess what? We got that. Read what you got.
John chapter 7, verse 38.
Read up.
He that believeth on me.
It says, he that believeth on me. Read.
As the scripture has said.
As the scripture has said.
Out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water.
What is that rivers of living water you talk about? What is the water according to the Bible? Because surely it says out of his belly shall flow, Ephesians 5:26, rivers of living water. What is the Bible talking about? Let's see if the Bible's gonna explain itself, sis.
Bring it up.
Ephesians 5:26.
Bring it up.
That he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word.
So we are here to sanctify and cleanse with the washing of the water. Keep reading.
By the word.
By the word of God. Guess what, Kiki? Once you start to listen to the words of God, it's going to clean your life up.
Right.
All that filth you surround yourself with, guess what? The word of God, that water is going to swoosh it all away.
Right.
You'll be forgiven for your sins. You'll be made that clean bride when Christ returns. You'll be that righteous seed that Jesus Christ comes to save.
That's right.
Now we done talked about what Jesus looked like. All right, that was easy. That was light work. A lot of people might understand that already. But let's talk about some of the things you don't understand. Let's talk about who we are as a people.
Read up.
Because this Bible only really makes sense when you can see yourself in it.
Right.
I asked you the question before. Have you ever been told that you're an Israelite? Can I prove it to you? Matter of fact, I'm going to teach you the history of the Israelites, and you be the judge if that happened to your people or not. Okay, little game. So, Deuteronomy 1:1. We're going to go to the beginning of this chapter. Now, a little bit of history lesson, right? You know who Moses is. What did Moses do, Kiki? He delivered the children of Israel out of Egypt. Are you familiar with the hell story? No? Okay. Well, maybe we can go over some of that too. Because guess what? We were delivered out of slavery and bondage after working in Egypt. Now, the ancient Egyptian empire was the world superpower at the time. You understand? And the Israelites were the slaves in that land. But Moses delivered the children of Israel out of Egypt. You understand? So, in like manner, it's the same comparison even today. Well, we are subjugated, well, we are oppressed, but guess what? It is a Savior return. So, let's get Deuteronomy 1:1.
Deuteronomy 1:1.
Uh-huh.
These be the words which Moses spake unto all Israel on this side Jordan in the wilderness.
So these be the words which Moses spoke to his people on the side of Jordan into the wilderness. You read it. Matter of fact, let's go to Deuteronomy. And let's talk about what happened to the children of Israel. What they had to endure.
Read up.
Deuteronomy 28:15.
Uh-huh.
But it shall come to pass, if thou wilt not hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God.
Because what we did not understand is that God gave Moses an ultimatum to give to the children of Israel. He said, listen, if you are obedient, you will be blessed. But if you're disobedient, you will be cursed. You'll be out here walking around not knowing who you are.
Right.
You'll be glorying in the other nations. How you doing, sisters?
Hi, how are you?
Did you know that you are not at your full strength, my sister, when you follow other customs of the other nations?
We do know.
Did you know that your actual true natural hair is more beautiful than mine ever will be, sister?
Right.
Have you been told that you are beautiful and you descended from the greatest people that ever walked on the face of earth, sister?
Right.
Can I talk to you just for a second? Because we envy, we envy our oppressors so much that we will go through amazing lengths to put leprous hair in our heads. We will go amazing lengths just to have a piece of an apple of the American pie.
Wait up,
all we really allotted is just the crumbs.
That's right.
We'll go through amazing length to bleach our skin, to do all these horrible things to ourselves just so we can look more appealing to our oppressor.
Right.
Proverbs 3:31.
This is a destroyed mind here. Read.
Envy thou not the oppressor.
Envy not the oppressor.
And choose none of his ways.
Choose none of his ways. That goes into your Christmas. That goes into your birthdays. That goes into your Thanksgiving. That goes into your Labor Day.
Right.
That goes into your Mother Day.
Yeah.
All of these things is tied into idolatry.
Right.
You know that the Father told us we cannot partake in these things. We cannot sit at the table of devils, as it says in 1 Corinthians 10 and 21. We cannot partake with the devil and then try to serve God.
Right.
We can't play it both sides. God said, if you love me, keep my commandments.
That's right.
Let's see what God has commanded us to do. Is it keep all of these customs, or is it to withdraw ourselves? Read what you got. Yeah.
1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 21. You cannot drink the cup of the Lord.
You cannot drink the cup of the Lord. You cannot sit up here and call yourself a follower of God. You can't even say you're really a Christian if you're not really following Christ. Read.
And the cup of the devil.
Hey, what's going on, y'all, fam? Hey, come on, man, in the room. Come on. Come talk to some poor men.
Did you know that your poor fathers are the greatest men on the face of earth? And I'll teach you about how King Solomon was the richest and the wealthiest king and the wisest.
Wait up.
Can I tell you about his father, David, who was the mightiest, who was a mighty man of God, one of his favorites? Can I tell you that you descend from the prophets and the kings?
Right.
We will return to that greatness.
That's right.
Or are we going to just cry aloud? Are we just going to cry aloud and no one hear?
We know.
But guess what? You're going to still hear this word.
Right.
And when the sky crack, you ain't going to have no excuse, nor any shelter for you on that day. So let's keep understanding that we cannot partake in the table of the devils. Read.
Ye cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of devils. Ye cannot be partakers of the Lord's table and of the table of devils.
We cannot play it both sides.
Right.
If I walk up the street and ask 10 people, do you love God? I'm going to get 10 yeses. Ain't nobody out here being real and say, no, I don't love God. I don't even know him. But when I look out here, this is exactly what I see. I see people that don't love God and that don't know him. How do you know if you love God or not? Let's see if the Bible tells you how to love God. Because I can ask a question right now. Hey, sister right there with your two children. Do you love God? Do you love God? Let's see how the Bible says you're supposed to love him. How you're supposed to prove how to love God.
The book of 1 John, chapter 5, verse 3. For this is the love of God.
So this is the true love of God.
That we keep his commandments.
That we keep his commandments. The commandments is what's going to get us into that tree of life.
That's right.
The commandments is what is going to fix our communities.
Right.
The commandments is what's going to teach us how to be good mothers, how to be good fathers,
right.
How to be better brothers, how to be teachers, how to clean up our neighborhoods.
Right.
The laws is what's going to set us free.
That's right.
You read it?
And his commandments are not grievous.
And the commandments ain't a hard thing to do.
Right.
Because guess what? It ain't hard for me to love my brother. It ain't hard for me not to kill or steal from my brother.
Right.
It ain't hard for me not to commit adultery with my brother's wife.
Read out.
These things are not hard to do. A lot of these things come second nature. If I have an odds with my brother, guess what? I'm going to step to him as a man and apply Matthew 18.
Right.
But these are things that are written in the Bible that we do almost on an everyday basis. But I understand. Common sense, right? Common sense has become a superpower nowadays. Because we don't know anything about the Bible.
Right.
We don't know anything about the knowledge of God. Let's get Hosea 4 and 16. This is going to be a common thing because guess what? We need that knowledge. Our community is a direct reflection to what we reject.
Right.
We reject God's laws, so therefore he rejects us and our children. Read.
4 and 16.
Okay. Hosea chapter 4 verse 6. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge.
The reason why we live in the ghettos, the reason why black on black crime skyrockets, the reason why we hate each other, the reason why we sell drugs to one another, the reason why we do all these different crimes and all these different things to ourselves is because we've been destroyed.
Right.
Destroyed from our own faults. Destroyed from our own actions. Destroyed from our own idolatrous practices. We destroy it for that lack of knowledge.
Nathaniel of Israel United in Christ. Please subscribe to our YouTube channels. Stay up to date with our latest events, music, and classroom lessons. IUIC plans to continue visiting different countries where this gospel has not been preached before. IUIC needs your help in pushing this truth. So join us, subscribe to our Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, and podcast, and stay up to date with us. For more information, please visit www.israelunite.org.